Be not ye therefore like unto them, talking about the heathen who pray in vain repetition. For your Father knows what things you have need of before you even ask them. I mean, I don't know about you, but that's comforting to me to know that God already knows in advance what it is that I need from Him. Amen. But nevertheless, He's asking us to pray in a certain manner. And Jesus wants to instruct us in that this morning through this word. He said, after this manner, therefore, pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven. And one of the things that, you know, I'm going to break this down real quick. This isn't the emphasis of my message, but I wanted to make a point. The God that you and I serve, He reigns in heaven. Amen. It's important that we understand that He's in a particular place, but it represents the fact that He's sovereign and that He's in control. There's an enemy of your soul, and there's an enemy of this land, and there's an enemy of the plan of God. And you can see it within this prayer that Jesus is wanting to bring our mind back to that, and it's certainly going to be in the midst of our message this morning. God is in heaven. He's sovereign, and He's in control. But the truth of the matter is that there's some things taking place down here on this earth that are not the way that God wants them to be. Jesus goes on to say, hallowed be thy name. And the word hallowed in the Greek is hagios, which is the same word that's translated as sanctified, and also it can also be used to mean holy. The word means that it's consecrated and it's separated. The name of God is hallowed, it's holy, it's consecrated, and it's separated. Now it's important that you understand that Jesus, as a Jewish rabbi, and the one that's bringing forth the new covenant, is speaking to the children of Israel. And if you understand the history of Israel, then you understand that they had a temptation and they fell again and again into idolatry and the worship of false gods. You need to understand that at the time, in the ancient times, God is desiring to reveal Himself to humanity, but because of humanity's sin and the enemy's influence through idolatry and false gods, mankind has been blinded and has been being moved in a direction opposite of God. God's name is to be consecrated. God's name is to be separated. God's name is to be made holy. And I have to tell you that it's come back around in the society that you and I live in. Many of you, when you were born and raised into a family where at least the name of Jesus was mentioned at times. As a matter of fact, more than likely, the family that you grew up in, if there was any talk about God, it was probably the God who sent His Son Jesus to die on the cross for your sin. In some way, shape, or form, the name Jesus was somewhat welcomed in the midst of your home. I have to tell you that that's changing in the midst of our society. It's been going on for at least 10, 15, 20 years. We live in the midst of a society where now the name of God is not hallowed. It's not consecrated. It's not separated. There's many gods in the world. We live in the midst of a global society. And you got to take each person's preference and you have to look at them and you have to respect them. And listen to me, I'm not saying that you don't respect people, but what I'm saying is that the book is either real or it's not. And there's either one God or there's not. And His name's either worthy to be hallowed, He's either the creator of the universe, and He's either the one that put breath inside a man's lungs, or He's not. Jesus said His name is hallowed, it's consecrated, it's separated, and for the people of God, we're supposed to understand that. He goes on to say, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, there's a lot to be said right there. Jesus just said you need to pray that God's kingdom, who's hallowed, consecrated, separated, that His kingdom would come to this earth. Well, what are you talking about, Jesus? You mean to tell me that God's kingdom isn't? No, listen, God's kingdom is not ruling and reigning upon this earth at this point in time. You understand that? Jesus, that there are two kingdoms that coexist upon this earth. I say it to you many times, but we need to get it deep down inside of our spirit. Jesus called Satan the prince of this earth three different times. When Adam fell the way of the serpent, he relinquished his dominion and his right to this earth to the liar. And the liar for thousands of years has gotten mankind, kings and rulers, to buy into his plan to be sovereign upon this earth. And we talked about it Thursday night if you were here. That there are a group of people who have been under the radar and who have secretly invited Satan to come back and take this world, and that they would allow him to be their Christ, and that they would allow him to be the ruler of their life, thinking that he's come to bring them light, thinking that he's come to bring them peace because they're deluded and that their minds have been blinded by the God of this world. That's what the Word of God says. Jesus tells us right here that we're to pray that God's kingdom come upon this earth. and that God's will would be done. And Jesus, manifest in the flesh, was the very kingdom of God, the very presence of God that came upon this earth. And I have good news for you, because I don't know if you've experienced it or not yet. But if you truly are a born-again child of God, and you truly have taken your heart, and with your heart believed in Jesus and what He did for you at the cross, and with your mouth confessed that Jesus died on the cross for you and He rose from the dead, then a miracle has taken place in your heart, and the kingdom of God has been planted on the inside of your heart. And if it's happened, hallelujah, you know what I'm talking about. It changes things. And you and I need to start understanding that so that we can keep our faith in it, so that we can walk upon this earth with the kingdom of God on the inside of us, because He's asking something from us. He's asking something from us, amen? He's asking that we would allow the light of God to shine in us and to shine out of us. And that this whole world isn't, this little vapor called life isn't just about us, amen? And about the American dream. I'm talking to your daddy this morning. Over there at the gym. A Vietnam veteran. Well, I just, you know, and my daddy was a Korean War veteran. And I was raised a patriot, you know, to believe in the country. And I still am thankful for this country that I was born in. Amen. I turned 10 in Singapore. I don't want to live there. I was in Venezuela. I don't want to live there. I went to Europe. I don't want to live there. Amen. But at the same time, I said it the other day, and I'm going to say it again, Jesus wasn't an American. And we're confused into thinking that this is what it's all about. The reality of it is this, is that God's kingdom needs to come. And in order for God's kingdom to come, the last days need to come upon us. And we need to quit worrying about preserving our American heritage. And we need to start holding on to Jesus. And we need to start holding on to the gospel. And we need to give the gospel to the people that are around us.
Amen.
I'm either right or I'm wrong. If I'm wrong, then pray for me. Amen. I don't think I'm wrong. Oh, I'm going to pray for the leaders. I'm going to pray for them. I'm going to ask God to move in the midst of the land. But if you think it's going to be fixed in a voting booth, I've been saying this for at least 3 years, you're wrong. It's not going to be fixed in a voting booth. We need to get on our knees and we need to trust God that He would move in the midst of the church.
Yes.
That we'd be less focused on a particular country and that we'd become more focused on a kingdom. Amen. The kingdom of God upon this earth. He goes on to say, for you and I today, we need to understand something. Give us this day our daily bread. God wants to take care of your individual life also. He wants to take care of your provision. He's concerned about what you need on a daily basis. He's not necessarily wanting the desire to make you rich. Some people will get rich, amen, on this earth, and I hope that they use their money. There were rich Christians in the New Testament church, and Paul exhorted them to give to the poor, amen. But the truth of the matter is that God does desire to take care of your daily bread. He wants to provide for you, and Jesus said you can pray for that. You can pray for God to provide for you on a daily basis, that you don't have to go hungry. I've never seen a child of God begging bread, amen. Trust Him, amen, and He will provide for you. Goes on to say, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. You know, the truth is that you and I desire to have forgiveness from God, but many times people do things in our lives that we don't like and we desire not to forgive them. The Word of God says that there's a direct correlation between forgiveness. Jesus died to purchase your forgiveness, but the fact is that if you want forgiveness from God, Jesus is letting you know that you also need to forgive others. Amen? It's a matter of the heart. We need to understand and come to the realization that left to ourselves, we're unworthy and we're not worthy of forgiveness. There's nobody in this room that's arrived. Amen. We're all dependent upon the blood of Jesus. Every last one of us is in a journey traveling. Amen. Desiring to see the kingdom of God come to life on the inside of our life that He might use us. He goes on to say this, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Now, I looked at that for a while there this morning. Jesus is saying, don't pray that the Lord would lead you into temptation. Don't pray that way. He said, as a matter of fact, I think that if Jesus was here and He could talk to us, I know I was led by the Spirit to go into the wilderness and to be tempted of the devil. You don't need to pray that you would find yourself in the midst of a trial or in the midst of the testing, because the word temptation there means to literally to be proved. You can be sure and certain that in this journey you will find yourself in the midst of a test. You will find yourself in the midst of a temptation. But what the Lord would say is instead of praying that you be led into temptation, you need to pray that you be delivered out. The Lord wants to deliver you out, amen. And the word deliver means to be snatched out, to be released, to be rescued. Hallelujah, Lord, deliver me out from the midst of the trial. Deliver me out from the midst of the test, amen. Lord, I desire to be proven to be who you say that I am. But Lord, help deliver me out, amen. Snatch me out of this situation. He says, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, that's good news for me. See, while on one hand Jesus says, pray that the kingdom of God would come, on the other hand, Jesus says that the kingdom and the power and the glory is God's. Ultimately, he's sovereign. I'm telling you, you have to believe what I'm telling you. God is sovereign and he's ultimately in control. And everything that happens in your life, he's allowing it to happen for a purpose. There's a bigger purpose that's going on behind the scenes, but the truth is that many times when we find ourselves in the midst of the chaos, all we can see is the trouble that lurks around the corner. All we can see is the storm that's brewing on the sea. And it's difficult for us to see what God's really desiring to do in our individual lives and on a grand scale also in the midst of this nation. As we see things changing, sometimes it's difficult to see the big picture. What are you doing, God? I'm telling you what he's doing. He's unfolding this thing. He's unfolding this thing and he's letting it come to its completion. And you and I, we don't know exactly what we face as time moves forward. But we do know who we have to hold on to, amen? Amen? And we do know that he that is in us, once again, is greater than he that is in the world. I titled this morning's message, you can turn to Acts chapter 10 now. I titled this morning's message, A Prayer Life That Changed the World. Amen. A couple of weeks back, the Lord put the name Cornelius on my heart. And I wanted to preach about the life of Cornelius. But before we get started, you know, I just wanted to talk a little bit about our timeline. Because you see, this prayer is, it's microscopic in the view of God. And what I mean by that is it kind of hones in, and Jesus kind of in a succinct or in a concise way, he explains to us what it is that we should expect on this earth. He talks about the kingdom of God, amen, and how God wants his kingdom to be upon the earth and how God wants his kingdom to be in the midst of his people. But at the same time, it also speaks about our individual lives, about how God desires to be involved in the midst of our individual lives. And so on a small scale, we've already gotten a taste of what's going on, amen, that God has a plan and that there's an enemy that's in the midst of all of this. And I just wanted to show you that on a grand scale, going back to the fall, things changed for humanity. Mankind was originally created in the image and likeness of God. Amen. He had no sin in him. But after the fall, we understand this, that sin began to spread throughout the entirety of the human race. But God had a plan. He called this man Abraham, who, you got to remember that there was no nation called Israel at one time. And that God called this man Abraham, and through this man Abraham, he promised to create a people for himself, and he promised to create a country for himself. And we know that what happened was that as time went forward, the children of Israel in Egypt became and swelled to a great nation. God had that in plan. He had that plan, and it was a part of his plan. It didn't look like it to the individuals on that day. It didn't seem like this could really be God's plan as they found themselves in the midst of slavery and captivity, as they found themselves under Pharaoh's hand. They didn't see how in the world could a God of love who gave promises to our father Abraham allow us to become slaves to Egypt, but it was all part of God's plan. And on that Passover night that we've talked about so many times, God delivered Israel out, and he delivered them through on dry ground, through the Red Sea, amen, and he delivered them towards the promised land that he had for them. But because of their disobedience, they wandered for 40 years, but they finally entered the promised land. But once again, because of disobedience and going after false gods, I think it's important that we be reminded of that. Again, today I've said it once, but I'll say it again. False gods. Heathen nations, meaning Gentile nations, meaning there's one nation that was created by God for himself named Israel. All the other nations, all the other people didn't know God. All they knew were the false gods that the enemy of their soul wanted them to serve. And it's important that we remember that, because in the midst of our message, it's going to talk about that. And so, whenever Israel entered into the promised land, there were other people there that served false gods. And they found themselves engaging in the ways of the world.
They connected themselves to the people of the world, and they began to partake in what the world partook of. And they found themselves in bondage because God allowed it to happen. But then came a day when John the Baptist came preaching in the Judean wilderness, "Prepare ye the way of the Lord." And Jesus showed up on the scene. Amen. And he began to preach the kingdom, that the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven is now at hand. In other words, Jesus told us to pray that the kingdom of God would come. And Jesus, when he shows up, says the kingdom of God is now at hand. Amen. Because he was the kingdom and he showed up on the earth. And like I've already said, if you're truly born again, you know what I'm talking about. Because the kingdom of God has been planted on the inside of your heart. Jesus dies on the cross. He resurrects from the dead. And on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit descends. The people are filled with, Peter's filled with the Holy Spirit. He preaches the first Holy Spirit message. 3,000 people get saved. And now we find from that day moving forward that we've been in the midst of something called the church age. For 2,000 years, this is where we live today. We're in the midst of the church age. If you look at all of this, you can see that really and truly the timeline of God, we're nearing the end. Amen? I mean, look at all the things that have taken place in the past according to what the scriptures say, and yet we find ourselves in the midst of the church age, and I'll be honest with you, I'm not so certain that we're not right here at the end of the church age. And in the midst of the church age, our story is in Acts chapter 10, and we're about to talk about that in a second. But after the church age comes the millennial reign of Christ. You and I have to understand, and I was talking about that this morning, we are getting so caught up in this temporary world, and I'm preaching to the preacher. We're getting so caught up in this temporary world and keeping our eyes on this thing that we experience with our senses, and God is wanting us to stay focused on the eternal. God is wanting us to stay focused on the plan that he has, and not on today, but instead to look forward to tomorrow, that we would accomplish what God has asked us to do on this earth in this time frame that he's given us, amen, to at least those that have been made aware of his plan. Those of us who have been had our eyes opened to the truth of what the scriptures speak, that he is real and that he has a plan, amen,
amen.
And that this time frame, which is temporary, and causes pain oftentimes, is just that. It's only temporary. Amen? And that we're to keep our eyes focused on the big plan of God. Amen? And that ultimately, after that day, after that millennial reign of Christ, will be the new heavens and the new earth. And so let's turn to Acts chapter 10. And we're not going to read right this second, but I kind of just want to tell you the story. So we're in the midst of the church age. Like I said, the Holy Spirit has descended and Peter preached, and 3,000 people got saved. And it wasn't long after that he preached again and 5,000 people got saved. And a couple of weeks back I preached a message that said Jesus stood up. You remember that? Jesus stood up. I preached on Stephen the martyr and how because of his life and because of his devotion to God and because of the way that he died for the faith, the heavens were opened and Stephen was able to see Jesus standing on the right hand of the Father, where the Word of God says in Hebrews that Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father because his work was a completed work. But on that day, Jesus stood up. Jesus stood up and he took notice of Stephen's faith and Stephen's willingness to give his life for the faith. But one of the things that I talked to you about was that's where the deacons of the church began. The word deacon literally means to be a servant, and that's what they were there for, to serve tables. The reason why they had to serve tables was because it said that there was a murmuring that was taking place because of the Grecian widows. The Grecian widows weren't getting their daily food proportions. You got to understand, people are coming into the church. People are coming into the church and they're being persecuted. They're being persecuted for their new faith and people are ostracizing them. And you can't get a job now. And you can't get a job and you can't put food on their table. And so somehow the Lord's providing for everybody and everybody's sharing with one another. Amen. And the disciples say, you need to pick 7 men from amongst yourself that are full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom. And you need to appoint them to do this task so that we can pray and study the Word of God. One of those men was Stephen. But what I wanted to tell you about was these Grecian widows. These Grecian people, you need to understand something, they were Jews. Even though they spoke Greek, they were Jewish by origin. They were what you call a proselyte. Alright? What's a proselyte? Well, let's just go ahead and take a second and talk about that. It's not what the modern church calls it. Like, as if you went to somebody else's church and tried to bring people over here, they call that proselytizing. That's not what a proselyte was. A proselyte was a person who was a Gentile What I tell you, with Gentile nations, heathen nations, all those other nations, it's okay still to teach the Bible, right? So that we understand what we're talking about. Every other nation other than the nation of Israel. And so a proselyte was a person who was a Gentile, meaning they were not Jewish by birth, but that they chose to serve the God of the Jews, and they went as far as saying, you know what, I believe he's so real, if he was a man, he would allow himself to engage in the rite of circumcision. Now that was a big thing. You had to know for sure that you really wanted to serve the God of Israel in order to do that. And if you would allow yourself to be circumcised and you would allow yourself to follow the dietary laws, you were considered a proselyte and you were allowed to now engage in synagogue and temple worship. Whereas if you were not, or at least temple worship, whereas if you were not a full-fledged proselyte, you were not allowed to go. So in the beginning stages of the book of Acts, whenever these Grecian widows are being neglected, they're either already born Jews, but they speak Greek, because you remember what we said, Alexander the Great came through, and through the process of Hellenism, everybody began to speak Greek, and the Greek culture invaded the land. So they were either born Jews, but yet had Grecian culture, or number two, they were proselytes and had converted to Judaism. But we also see in the midst of the text, and Cornelius is one of these people. Cornelius is a man that feared God, the Bible says. But he was not a full-fledged proselyte. He would have been like Candace's eunuch. You remember that? We talked about him a couple of weeks back too. He was one who, Candace's eunuch was the one that was sitting in the carriage, and he was reading the scriptures of the Jews, and he was in the book of Isaiah whenever Philip the deacon showed up, and he said, who is it that this book is talking about? And Philip said, do you understand who it is that you read about? He said, how can I unless somebody teach me? And the Bible says that Philip from that point preached Jesus to him out of the book of Isaiah. So Candace's eunuch was a God-fearer. Cornelius was a God-fearer, but they were not necessarily proselytes. The Word of God says that Cornelius was a man who was devout. He was a man who was devout. Let's go ahead and read the first four verses. It says, there was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian Band, a devout man and one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. He saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of God coming into him and saying unto him, Cornelius. And when he looked on him, he was afraid and said, what is it, Lord? And he said unto him, your prayers and your alms are come up for a memorial before God. Now, I want to tell you something. There's a few things that I would like to mention. So we see that Cornelius is in this time of prayer. And if you look later on in the chapter, we also see that he was actually fasting on this day. So Cornelius is seeking the face of God. And I was going to go ahead and show you this right here just to give you a little bit of a geographical idea of what we're talking about. This is Jerusalem right here where the temple of God is. And this is where Cornelius is. And what we're about to see in the story, this is where Simon Peter is. He's in a place called Joppa at a man's house named Simon the Tanner. And so here Cornelius is praying to God in Caesarea, and an angel shows up and speaks to him. And at the same time, Peter's about to go on a rooftop and he's about to be put into a trance. God's moving and operating in the midst of the world. And he moves and operates in the midst of individual people's lives. And Cornelius is a man who the Bible says is devout. It means that he was persistent in his seeking after God. He desired to know God. But listen, he was a Roman centurion. That means that he would have been a very prominent man in the Imperial Roman army. He had 100 soldiers that sat under him. He was a man of prominence. But somehow, some way, Cornelius came to the fact that the conclusion that the gods of Rome were pagan idolatry and that something was wrong. See, they engaged also in animal sacrifice. But their animal sacrifice was demonic, and it caused people to live immoral lives. Not only did they do animal sacrifice, but they also did human sacrifice, and they engaged in temple prostitution. And all of a sudden, somehow, some way, Cornelius was able to back up away from the situation. And he was able to look at it as a devout man, and he was able to say, something is wrong with the gods of the Roman world. What about the God of the Jews? They walk around here and they have their scriptures and they live their lives as a separated people. And Cornelius began to believe in the God of the Jews at some point in his life, and he studied their scriptures. And the Word of God says he was a devout man. He was a God-fearer. He reverenced the God of the Jews. And he was a man that was fasting, and he was a man that was spending time in prayer. His prayer life was a prayer life that changed the world. Now, I don't want you to misunderstand me. God had a plan the whole time. God was looking for somebody that he could allow this catalyst to take place, but his plan was all along that he was going to touch the whole world, amen, not just the Jewish people, but that he was going to touch the whole world. As a matter of fact, Jesus, before he ascended to the Father, said, "Tarry for me in Jerusalem. Wait for me in Jerusalem." He said, "The gift of the Father is going to come upon you, and you're going to become witnesses for me in Jerusalem," which is right here, right? The city. Jerusalem, Judea, the southern part, Samaria, and the outermost parts of the world. It's starting right here in Caesarea. This is the starting place for the outermost parts of the world. After this happens, and the Apostle Paul takes off, he's going to cross the Mediterranean Sea, they're going to find a woman named Lydia. And that's on the European soil. She'll be the first convert. And it was the Western civilization that affected America. What I want you to know is that the gospel has moved forward, and that God is looking for people, and he's looking for people like this centurion Cornelius, who was a devout man, a God-fearer. And the Word of God says that about the ninth hour. Now I want you to understand that the ninth hour, according to Jewish reckoning, was 3:00 in the afternoon. And the Jewish people always prayed at specific times. The book of Daniel chapter 6 says that Daniel, listen, this is an interesting story. The people that got, the king of the Persian Empire set 120 princes over his empire. One of them was Daniel, and the other princes were jealous of Daniel because he served the God of Israel. And so they made a plan to trick him. They made a plan to mess him up. And what they said was, they got the king to sign a decree, and he said that if anybody for the next, I can't remember if it was 30 days, prays or asks anything of any other god or any other king besides you, let him be found in the lion's den. You know what I noticed whenever I read that story? You know what Daniel did? He went home and he did what he always did. See, we just had a judgment take place on Friday, and I don't know about what you plan on doing, but I plan on going home and doing what I always did. I don't know what this is going to mean for our life as we move forward, but I tell you this, I ask God to give me the grace to do what I always did. And what Daniel did was he opened up his windows, and he got down on his knees, and he turned his face towards Jerusalem. See, the Word of God said, would tell us what we learned is that Babylon would be way over here, and Persia would be down here. And so Daniel turned his face towards Jerusalem. Now, why would he do that? I'm going to tell you why he would do that. And I took a couple pictures, and I wanted to show you this. This is the tabernacle. There's a progression that takes place with the children of Israel. They're wandering, and we're talking about prayer this morning. We're talking about a prayer life that changed the world. And right now, I'm just talking to you about people that are praying, and that Cornelius, he doesn't even really know God yet. Oh, he wants to know the God of the Jews, you understand? But there's been a change that's taken place. Jesus has come, and he's died on the cross. Amen. And he's paid the penalty for man's sin. And Cornelius desires to know God. And God desires for mankind to know him. And so God is intervening in the midst of Cornelius' life. But right now we're just talking about prayer. And this is the tabernacle where the Jewish people would wander in the wilderness. And this is the altar of sacrifice. See, the truth of the matter is the presence of God is back here behind the veil. We're going to talk about that in a second. The presence of God is back here behind the veil. But before you're ever going to enter in through here, you've got to do work right here. And this is the altar of sacrifice. Represents the cross. Jesus had to die on the cross to pay the penalty of our sin. You and I can't enter into the presence of God until we first do business with God here. And this is the bronze laver where they would wash the blood off. And then you would enter in, and there were various articles that took place. That was the wilderness tent as they traveled through. But as time went forward, Solomon built a temple. I didn't mean to go. You saw it. It was big. I'm trying to go back. It was big. It still had the altar. It had the brazen laver. But what I wanted you to see is on the inside right here. These are the things that are taking place. I'm not going to go through them all, but there was a veil right here. You see that veil back here? There was something called the Ark of the Covenant. We talked about that a lot. And the reason why I talked to you about that is because that's where the presence of God was located. This is the Ark of the Covenant. And inside of this box were the Ten Commandments. the Ten Commandments, which was the law of God. And this was called the mercy seat on top. And these were the angels, which represented the presence of God. And once a year, they would put blood on top of this mercy seat. And these angels who are looking down, now they're looking at the blood. Amen. And the truth of the matter is that you and I are guilty, born of Adam. But that Jesus died. And Paul said that he is our mercy seat. That's what it says in the Greek language. Jesus is our mercy seat. And when the Father looks, he's no longer seeing your guilt and your failure. Instead, he's seeing the blood of Jesus. Amen. And it's because of the Day of Atonement, and it's because the blood was placed on the mercy seat that God's presence dwelled here. And what I want you to know is this, is that it was the ninth hour when Cornelius was praying. And the Bible says that Daniel would pray three times a day and he'd set his face towards Jerusalem. Why would he set his face towards Jerusalem? Because in Jerusalem was the temple. And in the temple was the veil. And behind the veil was the Ark of the Covenant. And on top of the Ark of the Covenant was a mercy seat. And upon that mercy seat, blood was applied. And because the blood was applied, the presence of God was allowed to dwell with his people. And so when a Jewish man went to pray, he would turn his face towards the temple because he wanted to be in the presence of God. And when a Jewish man wanted to pray, he'd pray at 9 o'clock in the morning at the time of the morning sacrifice, and he'd pray at 3 o'clock in the afternoon at the time of the evening sacrifice. And what I need you to know is that without the right sacrifice, there's no access to the presence of God. And the Word of God says that Cornelius, about the ninth hour at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, he's seeking the face of God. He's fasting because he's a devout man. And the angel of the Lord shows up and says, Cornelius, your prayers and your alms have come up as a memorial before God. Hallelujah. Alms, the charitable giving. See, you can't earn your way into the presence of God. As a matter of fact, much of the modern church today, they desire to push forward an agenda of a social gospel where all we do is we help people's physical needs. I'm not opposed to helping people's physical needs. But if we don't give them the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, then we haven't helped them at all. You can fill somebody's belly up today, but if you don't fill their heart up with Jesus, they're going to be hungry again tomorrow. The Lord knows how to fix things. Amen?
Amen. Yes, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. And so, but nevertheless, when the real Jesus shows up on the inside of your heart, you have a desire to want to give. And God had showed up and had an effect on Cornelius' life. And he was giving alms to the poor. And not only that, the Bible said he prayed always. Not only did he just pray at 9:30 and a little bit at the nighttime, but every opportunity he had, he interceded and he went to the God of heaven in prayer. And when this angel shows up, he says, Cornelius, your prayers and your alms have come up as a memorial before God. You know, the word memorial, literally, it describes something physical to you and I. It's like a placard or a plaque, a memorial, a veterans war memorial, some kind of a, like they have the one about the Vietnam veterans. It's a memorial that has everybody's name that died in Vietnam. Or a memorial cemetery for all the soldiers that have died. And when your eye sees it, you're supposed to be reminded. Memorial Day. When Memorial Day shows up, it's supposed to remind you that soldiers have died for the cause of the country. Right? In the book of Exodus, chapter 12, it said in that passage of scripture that every year when you have the Passover, you're supposed to do it as a memorial. It's a memorial, and one day your kids are going to grow up. Remember, we talked about that a while back. And they're going to ask, why do we do this, Daddy? And you're going to tell them, because our God delivered us out from under Egypt with a mighty hand. And so a memorial has come up before God. I was thinking, it's kind of like a notification on your phone. You got a smartphone? And I mean, I don't know about you, but I know people are tired of hearing it, but everybody's so busy nowadays. Right? We all got an excuse, man. I'm just busy. And so the smartphone's going to help you remember. Now, you can shoo it away. You can just kind of slide it and forget that they really texted you or that they called you if that's what you choose to do. But until you see the memorial right there and you deal with it, it's going to remind you in your mind. It's something physical that you see. I got to tell you, you think you're busy. God, if I would be able to speak in human terms, is really busy. He's been moving and operating in the midst of humanity for a long time. Amen. The Word of God says, in the fullness of time, Jesus was born of a virgin. He was born of a woman. Amen. And what we talked about was he waited till the right time, till all the civilized world spoke Greek, till the Romans had made the road so the gospel could go forward. And in the midst of all of this, and he's allowing everything to happen, all of a sudden, he keeps getting notifications. God keeps getting notifications from Cornelius. He prayed again today. Not did he just pray three times today, but he prayed five times today. He gave alms again today. This Cornelius, whatever he was doing in the midst of his prayer life, was getting a hold of God, and it was sending God notifications and reminding him, and it came up as a memorial before God. And God said, you know what? I'm going to respond to Cornelius. And he sent an angel. And that angel showed up to Cornelius' house, and he told him, this is what you have to do. Because see, even though you're devout, even though you're a man that prays always, even though you're a man that gives money to the poor, you're still not right in the eyes of God. See, religion won't get you there. God had changed the economy. God had changed the way that a man has access to the grace of God. Don't tell me that all religions are equal. No, because the Word of God says that it's not true. Even though Cornelius did all of these things, that to you and I, he probably had a more devoted life than any of us in this room. But even in the midst of all of that, it wasn't good enough. God sent an angel to let him know, this is what you got to do. You need to send some people to Joppa. And you need to inquire of one named Simon Peter. He's lodging at a man named Simon the Tanner's house, which is by the sea. And the Word of God says that at the same time, God is telling, a little bit before God even spoke to Cornelius, he was already speaking to Peter. Because it says at the sixth hour, Peter went up on the rooftop to pray. It said that he had become hungry, and he would have eaten, but yet he fell into a trance. I was thinking when I was reading that, Peter, you don't have time to eat physical food right now. There's a man that's hungry in Caesarea. He's hungry because he's fasting and he's hungry for the truth and he desires to know God and he's a devout man and he's seeking the face of God. And listen, Peter, you don't have time to eat physical food. And God allows Peter to go into a trance. And in the midst of this trance, all of a sudden it was like a sheet that was knitted at all four corners. He had a vision. And in this sheet was filled with all kinds of unclean animals, four-footed beasts, creeping things, all forms of unclean animals. And the sheet descended, and all of a sudden, a voice from heaven spoke and said, Peter, rise, kill, eat. Peter said, not so, Lord. My mouth has never eaten anything common or unclean. Three different times, the same thing happened. The sheet descended, the same thing was in the midst of the sheet, unclean animals, four-footed beasts, creeping things. Peter, rise, kill, eat. Not so, Lord, my mouth has never tasted anything unclean, I've never eaten anything common. The word common is the opposite of consecrated. It means it's the thing that everybody else in the world is doing. It means everybody else is doing it, I'm not going to eat that. Listen, there's a deeper picture here and I never saw it before. We're going to go into it a little bit, but I want you to know that this, the word kill right here has to do with what you do with a sacrificial animal. There's more to the picture than meets the eye here. This is more than just eating because you're hungry. God's telling them, get up, sacrifice, and eat this. On the Passover, that's what they did. They consumed the lamb. Jesus said in John chapter 6, he said, you must eat my flesh and you must drink my blood. The Passover was pointing to the day that Jesus would say that. And we have a whole group in the church that thinks you're supposed to literally turn the bread into the flesh of Jesus. That wasn't what God was talking about. And Jesus turned around and said it. He said, the flesh profits you nothing. The spirit is what gives you profit. My words are spirit and they are life. And the Word of God and the truth of Jesus, he's supposed to be our nutritional food. And we're supposed to feed on him, amen? And it gives us the energy from the Holy Spirit in order to move forward on a daily basis to live for him. But God is sending these unclean animals in this sheet. And he's saying, rise, Peter, kill, sacrifice, and eat. And Peter's like, not so, Lord. I don't eat common things. I don't eat unclean things. And finally, what the Lord tells him is this. Don't call common or unclean what I have cleansed. See, God's wanting to get a hold of Peter. Just as he wants to get a hold of Cornelius' heart.
God also has to get a hold of the church's heart. God has to get a hold of your heart. God has to get a hold of my heart. Because if we have the wrong attitude about the people that are in the world out there, well, you got to understand something. They don't know any better. I told y'all the other day that I had a conversation with that little gay guy at the clinic. And his point was is that I just feel like if we just all love each other, that we'll all be okay. And so I had to ask him, I said, but what is true love? Is true love just going along with you and saying that everything's going to be fine in the end? Or is true love going to tell you that the Word of God, that God is real and He wrote His Word, and that the Word of God says that there's some things that aren't right? And I'm preaching to the preacher too. There's things that aren't right, but there's some things that God calls an abomination. And is it okay? I didn't say all that, but I said, would true love tell you the truth, or would it just act like everything's fine? And in the midst of the society that we live in, that's where we are. Everybody wants to call it true love. Just let people live their life the way that they choose to. And if we're not careful as the people of God, like Peter, we'll have the wrong thought process. And we'll think that people are unworthy. We'll think that homosexuals are unworthy to get saved. Truth of the matter is Jesus died for the homosexual. Amen. Truth of the matter is Jesus died for the fornicator. Jesus died for the drug addict. And you and I can become so holy or so righteous in our understanding of the gospel that we don't believe anybody else has a right to come in. At the same time, God's wanting to get a hold of Cornelius' heart. God's wanting to get a hold of Peter's heart. He said, rise, Peter, kill and eat. Now, for sake of time, I'm going to just tell you about one of these passages I wanted to tell you about. I was going to read it, but in Genesis chapter 7, with the flood, the Word of God uses the same terminology. Creeping things, beasts, beasts of the earth. They died. God saved the ones that He wanted in the midst of the ark, and the rest of that flesh died along with sinful man that day in the flood. Now I want you to know that there were things going on pre-flood that you and I can't even wrap our minds around. I don't have time to get into it. Things that took place between fallen angels and daughters of men. Things that took place, I believe, between animals, and that there was crazy things happening. Demonic, satanic worship happening upon the earth in a way like you can't even imagine in the midst of your mind. And that is why God destroyed the world with a flood. But listen to me. I wanted you to turn, if you have your Bibles, to Romans chapter 1 real quick. Because I'm trying to make a point that for the first time I saw that there was something, I believe, even deeper here. Because you see, Cornelius had made a choice not to serve the gods of Rome. And Cornelius had made a choice to try to serve the God of Israel. But Cornelius is just a stepping stone that God wants to reach out and to touch the whole Gentile world. That's why I called this morning's message a prayer life that changed the world. Because Cornelius and his household are about to receive the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they're going to be the first converts that were not Jewish in birth or proselytes as Jewish. They're the first Gentile converts that the world had ever known. What is a Gentile? It's you and it's me, because we weren't born Jewish. This is a huge movement, a huge moment in the midst of the church. But I wanted you to see in Romans chapter 1, it says in verse 16, and we're just going to go ahead and read this. I didn't plan on it, but since what happened Friday, I think we should. It says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Greek also could be interpreted Gentile or heathen, nations that don't know God, the God of Israel. You got to start thinking like that. That's what the scripture's saying. To the Jew first. God came to the Jews first. Peter was a Jew. They got saved. And now God's going to send Peter to Cornelius, who's a Gentile in Caesarea. It goes on to say, verse 17, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. You shouldn't be surprised by what happened Friday. As the world suppresses the truth of God's word, as our nation suppresses the truth of God's word, the wrath of God is revealed from heaven. And this type of wrath is different. It's kind of like the frog in the water pot. It's slow. And you don't even realize it's happening. And your mind and your heart become darkened towards the things of God. And it says right here, that the wrath of God is revealed against this unrighteousness, verse 19, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of Him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. In other words, God made these things. God created creation. And mankind should have realized that there was a God when he saw creation. He should have been able to see it with his eyes and think about it with his mind. That there was a God in heaven that formed these things and breathed life into the midst of them. But instead, this is what they did. Even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because this is why. Because when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. And what they did was they changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. These are all the things except for man that was in that sheet that was lowered for Peter to see. What the Word of God is saying here is that mankind, with his hands, is forming statues, forming idols, whether they be of human beings or whether they be of beasts. And these statues, they're turning around instead of saying, God of heaven, you're the one that created heaven and earth and all that in them is. You're the one that put breath inside and gave life to all of these things. Instead, man with his feeble little hands forms a statue and molds it and then says, you're now my God. You're now access to my God. And the way that they learned these things was from demonic spirits from of old. And that's why God destroyed the land to begin with. Because this is something that they were doing back then. They were making images of these things. And all these pagan nations and all these Gentile nations, they don't know the real God of Israel. They don't know the God that would ultimately bring Jesus. All they knew was these unclean animals and these images that were being made and the worship of this idolatry. And God is wanting to let Peter know, listen, don't call common or unclean what I've made clean, because the plan is not just you as a Jew, but also the entirety of the world I plan to save. Amen. And listen to me. I think that God would have even told Peter something like this. Did you forget what your brother Andrew told you the first day that he heard John the Baptist preach about Jesus? Y'all remember that story? The Bible says that Andrew, which was Peter's brother, was with John when John the Baptist was baptizing. And the Word of God said that Jesus showed up on the scene. And John the Baptist said, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin, not just of Israel, but the sin of the entire world. And listen, the first thing Andrew did was he ran and he found Peter. He said, we found the Messiah. He's here. He finally showed up after all this time. Jesus showed up. And listen, you aren't going to tell me that he didn't tell him what John said. John said he is the Lamb of God who came to take away the sin of the whole world. And now Peter's up on this roof and God's got to put him in a trance. Amen. God's got to put him in a trance to get his heart right. To let him see it's not just about you and your Jewish people. It's about the whole world. Get rid of your religious mindset. Get your heart right before God so that God can use you, amen, in the life of a sinner. Doesn't mean that we're going to water down the message. We're going to tell them the truth, amen?
Amen.
Well, let's not stop right here. Let's go ahead and keep going. They changed the glory of God. It says in verse 24, wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. If you got a pen and a paper, you need to go ahead and mark this. If you've got a highlighter, you need to mark it in your Bible. Go ahead, dude. If you've got it memorized, you don't have to follow my lead. If you don't have it memorized, you need to write it down. You need to highlight it in your phone, because what happened Friday, you need to be ready. If you got any kind of life of God on the inside of you, you got to be ready, because see, a line was just drawn in the sand. I'm not trying to make a bigger deal out of it than what it is. I knew it was going to happen. I'm not even surprised. God's surely not surprised. But as you watch the way people respond in the midst of social media, and even maybe people in your own house that you might not be aware of, listen to me, the younger society, oh, everybody's got a right to love. Come on, somebody. What I'm trying to say is that the Word of God is real clear on some things.
And the fact of the matter is that God's not okay with homosexuality. God's not okay with us transgressing His laws. And the Word of God is clear in all these things. And what they're going to tell you is that, oh man, all that stuff about being gay, that's in the Old Testament. No, that's a lie. It's a lie from the pit of hell. It's right here in Romans chapter 1. Men that suppress the truth of God, God pours wrath upon them and He begins to darken their heart. And He begins to darken their mind to the point that they can't see right. We have people in the midst of the church that can't see right. And this is what He goes on to say. For this cause, verse 26, God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. What does that mean? They got rid of men and the natural anatomical creation that God created. And instead, they threw away the men, and women started lying with women. That's what it says. It goes on to say in verse 27, and likewise also the men leaving the natural use of the woman burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error, which was meet. In other words, it was due for them. They received the judgment that was right for them, and it's coming, and God's the one that wrote it, not Matt. They may not like that Matt's willing to read it, but the fact of the matter is that it's in the Word of God, and there we're going to read it, and we're going to talk about it. It says in verse 28, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. You don't want to think about God in your life? Sooner or later, you'll turn your mind over to the point where you can't even function right. Goes on to say, verse 29, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, look at this, that they which commit such things are worthy of death. But look at this. Don't fall asleep on me right here. This is really important. People that engage in all of this are worthy of death. Not only those that do the same, but those that have pleasure in them that do it. If you look at other translations, it says those that condone their behavior. Those that are in union with them and say, you know what? I don't really roll that way. If I'm a woman, I don't lay with women. If I'm a man, I don't lay with men. That's not my flavor. But you know what? You my friend, and you got a right to live your life whatever the way you want to live your life. It's all cool. We good. We groovy. Fist bump. We still friends. And it's all like that. Listen, the Word of God says if you condone their behavior, if you're a partaker with them, if you're not taking a stand in the midst of what's going on, the line's been drawn in the sand, you got to take a stand and you got to make a choice on who it is you're going to serve. Amen. And so Lord help us is all I can say as time moves forward and we see these things changing in the midst of our society that we ask the Lord to give us the strength that we need to do the right thing. So here we're back to Peter now. I went off on a rabbit trail. We're back to Peter and he's in a trance. He was hungry and the Lord put him in a trance because there's a man hungry for spiritual food and God needs to get Peter's heart right. And he sees these unclean animals and all Peter can think about is demonic sacrifices. And these things are unclean. And this is what the Gentile nations eat. And my mouth doesn't eat these things. And God's saying, don't you call unclean what I've made clean. Because the blood of Jesus was always the plan. And my plan was always to reach out to Gentile nations. He said, now get down from this roof. And there's some men that are waiting for you at the door. And you're to go with them. And you're to trust me in all of this. Because I'm in the midst of it all. So Peter goes over with them back to Caesarea. We saw the map. It was about 30 miles away from Joppa. And it says that certain in verse 22, and they said, Cornelius the centurion, whenever Peter came down, he's a just man, and one that fears God and of good report among all the nation of the Jews, was warned from God by a holy angel to send for thee into his house and to hear words of thee. Then called he them in and lodged them, and on the morrow, the next day, Peter went away with them, and certain brethren from Joppa accompanied him. So not only now we have a group of Gentiles that have come to Peter's house or to Simon the Tanner's house to get Peter, but now Peter's leaving with a group of Jews and they're heading back to Caesarea to go find Cornelius. It says in verse 28, he said unto them, you know how he shows up at the house and there's some people in the house that are waiting for him. And he says unto them, you know that it is unlawful thing for a man that is a Jew to keep company or come unto one of another nation. But God has showed me that I should not call any man common or unclean. God had to really get a hold of Peter's heart. I mean, can you imagine this? In other words, Peter wasn't about to go to Cornelius' house. It doesn't matter how much Cornelius is praying. It doesn't matter how many notifications are making it to God's face. If God doesn't show up and get a hold of Peter's heart, he's never going to travel over here, because all of his life he's believed that as a Jew he's not supposed to be in the home of a Gentile. But the Lord showed him three times when he saw that vision. God got a hold of Peter's heart and explained to him, don't you call unclean or common what I have made clean. And it goes on to say that and Cornelius tells him the story about what happened as he was praying and how what the angel told him. And then it says right here in verse 33, immediately therefore I sent to you, and you have done well that you are come. Now therefore are we all here present before God to hear all things that are commanded you of God. We're all waiting, Peter. We're all waiting here. We've all assembled. We're in the midst of the house. We're ready to have church. We're so glad that you showed up. Tell us the truth. And then the Bible says that Peter opened his mouth and he said of a truth. He said, I perceive that God is no respecter of persons. But in every nation, he that fears him and works righteousness is accepted with him. You know what? You can't work your way towards righteousness. But what Peter's saying is that if there's a man that desires to find the righteousness of God, God's not a respecter of persons. And I can assure you that he will show up and he will reveal the truth to you. And that's what this whole thing is about. It goes on to say, the word which God sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. You know what the word of God says in Romans chapter 5? That we have peace through Jesus Christ. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God. What does the word justified mean? It means to be declared legally innocent in the eyes of God. How did that happen? God sent his son Jesus to die on the cross. And when you put your faith in that, amen, God pronounced you as righteous in his eyes. That's how you got peace with God. If you haven't received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and if your family goes to another church somewhere, but they're not justified because they haven't put their faith in Jesus Christ and what he did for them at the cross, they can't be at peace with God. It goes on to say right here that the word, verse 36, which God sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, that he is Lord of all. Verse 37, that word I say you know, which was published throughout all Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached. John preached the baptism of repentance. Part of the process of becoming saved is that a man must repent. Amen? The word repentance means to change your mind. Sometimes we have mindsets that are wrong. And God is wanting our mind to line up with his mind. Amen?
Amen.
He's wanting our thoughts and our minds and our actions to line up with his mind, his thought, and his actions. Amen. Lord, we need your help to change our mind. We need your help to cause us to knit ourselves to you, amen, and to walk according to your will. I repent. I was wrong. I thought I was going the right way, but I wasn't going the right way. Lord, I need to line up according to your will. Jesus is the Christ. He is the Messiah. And there's no way to have a relationship with you unless I put my faith in his cross. Amen. Yes. And walk with you and trust in that each and every day.
Yes.
Then it goes on to say right here that in verse 38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Remember how we talked about in that prayer, your kingdom come, your will be done? Remember how I told you that the enemy of God was upon this earth? And that this word oppressed literally means tyranny. It describes the tyrannical rule of a king. What I need you to know is that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth, and in him he had power to deliver those and heal those that were under the tyrannical rule of the evil one. He delivered them out of that bondage and set them free, and that was made manifest for all eyes to see. You and I need to understand that we're no longer under the rule of the king of Satan. Instead, we're under the rule of King Jesus, and by his grace and his strength, he can give us the power that we need, amen, to walk right with God.
Thank you, Lord.
It says, and we are witnesses of all things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hanged on a tree. They hung him on a tree. They put him on the cross. He was a sacrifice. But God raised him up the third day. See, death had no right to hold him down. He had no sin in him. The Word of God says in Romans 6:23 that the wages of sin is death. Jesus had no sin in him, and therefore he came out of the grave. Amen?
Amen.
Not to all the people, verse 41, but unto witnesses chosen before of God, even to us who did eat and drink with him after he rose. We saw him with our own eyes. We ate with him, we drank with him. The resurrection happened. And he commanded us to preach unto the people and to testify that it is he which is ordained of God to be the judge of the quick and the dead, the living and the dead. Jesus has power over death, amen? He is the resurrection and the life, and one day he will judge. The judgment is coming. And all I know is that I thank God for his blood. God, none of us in this room are perfect, but the thing that makes us different is that we've put our faith in the sacrifice of the sinless one, and we've been clothed with his righteousness. And at the same time, God desires to give us strength to walk right and to do what it is that he's called us to do. To him give all the prophets witness that through his name, whomsoever believeth in him shall receive remissions of sins. All the prophets of the Old Testament were telling us that he was coming. They gave witness to the fact that Jesus was the Messiah, that he was the Lamb of God, that he was the one that was going to set the captive free. And when we preach remission of sins in his name, and people put their faith in it. See, the word remission means not only to just be forgiven, but to be delivered from the power of sin. I got good news for you this morning. Jesus' obedience on the cross delivers you and I from the power of sin. Amen. We need to just continue to trust in Christ and what he's done, and we will receive grace to be strengthened and be delivered from the power of sin. The Word of God goes on to say, and I know I've kind of preached long this morning, it goes on to say that while they were hearing the words from Peter, the Holy Spirit fell on them in that room, and they began to speak with other tongues. Now, you got to understand that what happened undoubtedly is this, is that as they heard the gospel preached, they believed not just with their head, but with their heart. They received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior in their heart, and they were instantly filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. Baptized in the Holy Spirit, began to speak with other tongues. Peter said, who can forbid them water? It just bypassed the whole water baptism thing. He hadn't even been water baptized yet. They've been saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, speaking in other tongues, and now Peter said, who can forbid them to be baptized in water? But what you got to understand is, he goes on to say this, that all the Jews that were with Peter were astounded. They were astounded because they saw the same thing happen to these Gentiles that had only been happening to Jews. That they also were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues.
Amen.
Amen. And that they're saying, that they're astounded by this, that God's Spirit is moving upon not just the Jewish nation, but he's moving upon the Gentiles also, because the Word of God says that he was the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Amen. I wanted to close with this. I was going to read it, but it's too long. Romans chapter 10. It says that you hear, that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And it talks about the fact that we need a preacher. How can they hear and believe if they don't have a preacher? And you know, it's not just the preacher that stands behind the pulpit, but you also are called to be a preacher. You also are called through your life and from time to time when God opens up a door for you to speak a word of truth into someone's life that needs to hear the truth. The hearing of faith. When the Word of God goes forth and you hear, you respond by faith. And the way that you respond is that you believe with your heart and you confess with your mouth. And when you happen, the Word of God says you get saved. And when you get saved, the Holy Spirit comes to live on the inside of your heart. So I want to encourage you and to see that Cornelius, the reason I titled it, that this was a life of prayer that changed the world. These were the first non-Jewish people that were ever saved. God moved mightily in that house on this day. Amen. And that he's been moving on the earth ever since then. And I just wanted to leave you with a couple of things. Number one, I want you to know that you can touch the heart of God if you choose to. Amen. Cornelius touched the heart of God. He made himself a devout man, a man that prayed always, and he wanted to get a hold of God. And listen to me, anybody that really wants to get a hold of God can, and if they desire to seek truth, God will show up and reveal truth to them. Amen. Number two was a point that I missed. The Word of God says that there were household people in Cornelius' household. Once again, he was a soldier over 100 people. And there were people in his household, and another soldier, it said in verse 7, that was a devout man also. The point is that they saw Cornelius' life, and he had effect on their lives. Amen. And I want you to know that when we learn to live for the Lord, our lives can also be contagious and can begin to change other people's lives.